Now we come to the next sutta, 85, Bodhi Raja Kumara Sutta, the Prince Bodhi. Thus have I heard. On one occasion, the Blessed One was living in the Bhaga country at Sungsumaragira in the Besakala Grove, the deer park. Now on that occasion, a palace named Kokanada had recently been built for Prince Bodhi, and it had not yet been inhabited by any recluse or Brahmin or any human being at all. Then Prince Bodhi addressed the Brahmin student Sanjika Putta thus, "Come, my dear Sanjika Putta, go to the Blessed One and pay homage in my name with your head at his feet and ask whether he is free from illness and affliction and is healthy, strong and abiding in comfort, saying, Venerable Sir, Prince Bodhi pays homage with his head at the Blessed One's feet and asks whether the Blessed One is free from illness and affliction, etc. Then say this, Venerable Sir, let the Blessed One, together with the Sangha of monks, consent to accept tomorrow's meal from Prince Bodhi." "Yes, Sir," Sanjika Putta replied, and he went to the Blessed One and exchanged greetings with him. When this courteous and amiable talk was finished, he sat down at one side and said, "Master Gotama, Prince Bodhi pays homage with his head at Master Gotama's feet and asks whether he is free from illness and affliction, etc., and abiding in comfort. And he says this, let Master Gotama, together with the Sangha of monks, consent to accept tomorrow's meal from Prince Bodhi." The Blessed One consented in silence. Then knowing that the Blessed One had consented, Sanjika Putta rose from his seat, went to Prince Bodhi and told him what had happened, adding, "The recluse Gotama has consented." Then when the night had ended, Prince Bodhi had good food of various kinds prepared in his own residence, and he had the Kokanada palace spread with white cloth down to the last step of the staircase. Then he addressed the Brahmin student Sanjika Putta thus, "Come, my dear Sanjika Putta, go to the Blessed One and announce that it is time thus. It is time, Venerable Sir, the meal is ready." "Yes, Sir," Sanjika Putta replied, and he went to the Blessed One and announced that it was time thus. "It is time, Master Gotama, the meal is ready." Then it being morning, the Blessed One dressed, and taking his bowl and outer robe, went to Prince Bodhi's residence. Now on that occasion, Prince Bodhi was standing in the outer porch, waiting for the Blessed One. When he saw the Blessed One coming in the distance, he went out to meet him and paid homage to him. And then allowing the Blessed One to precede him, he proceeded to the Kokanada Palace. But the Blessed One stopped at the lower step of the staircase. Prince Bodhi said to him, "Venerable Sir, let the Blessed One step on the cloth, let the Sublime One step on the cloth, that it may lead to my welfare and happiness for a long time." When this was said, the Blessed One was silent. A second time and a third time, Prince Bodhi said to him, "Venerable Sir, let the Blessed One step on the cloth, let the Sublime One step on the cloth, that it may lead to my welfare and happiness for a long time." The Blessed One looked at the Venerable Ananda. The Venerable Ananda said to Prince Bodhi, "Prince, let the cloth be removed. The Blessed One will not step on a strip of cloth. The Tathagata has regard for future generations." So Prince Bodhi had the cloth removed, and he had seats prepared in the upper apartments of the Kokanada Palace. The Blessed One and the Sangha of monks ascended the Kokanada Palace and sat down on the seats that had been prepared. Stop here for a moment. Here this incident where the Buddha refused to step on that long piece of white cloth, like a carpet laid out for him. According to the Atakatta, the commentary, they say that the prince had no children and he wanted a son to succeed him. So he made a wish that if the Buddha stepped on the cloth, his wish will be granted, that he would have a son. So according to the commentary, the Buddha saw that because of his bad karma, he had no son and he was not going to have a son. Maybe in previous life he killed somebody's son. So the Buddha refused to step on the cloth because the Buddha didn't want to give him the impression that the Buddha could not fulfill his wish. That is what the commentary says, lah. But it's not very likely, lah. We can see from the Vinaya books that the Buddha was very strict on a lot of things, lah. What was considered luxurious, the Buddha did not allow, lah. So, like remember Ananda says, the Tathagata has regard for future generations. So it would seem like the Buddha did not want to create this precedent where monks are treated like royalty, so that in future, if he step on this cloth, next time other people also will lay out this cloth for monks to step on. So in the Vinaya rules, the Buddha forbid monks from stepping on this type of cloth laid out like a carpet as though for royalty. But later, because of lay people pleading with him and all that, so he relented. Sometimes the Buddha, in the beginning, is very strict, but later, sometimes he relents. Then with his own hands, Prince Bodhi served and satisfied the Sangha of monks headed by the Buddha with the various kinds of good food. When the Blessed One had eaten and had withdrawn his hand from the bowl, Prince Bodhi took a low seat, sat down at one side, and said to the Blessed One, "Venerable Sir, we have thought thus. Pleasure is not to be gained through pleasure. Pleasure is to be gained through pain. Prince Bodhi, before my enlightenment, while I was still only an unenlightened bodhisattva, I too thought pleasure is not to be gained through pleasure. Pleasure is to be gained through pain. Later, while still young, a black-haired young man endowed with the blessing of youth in the prime of life." So here the Buddha quotes Sutta 26, paragraph 15 to 17. Basically, let me see, page 2, 5, 6 to 9. Here the Buddha talk about his search for enlightenment. Then he went to Alara Kalama, his first meditation teacher, and learned meditation, attained the Arupa Jhana, and was not satisfied with that because it did not lead to enlightenment. Then after that, he went to another teacher, which was Udaka Ramaputta, and Udaka Ramaputta taught him a higher meditation, also an Arupa Jhana. And also he attained that, but was not satisfied, and left Udaka Ramaputta. And then after that, he came to a suitable place for striving. The Buddha said, "Now three similes occurred to me spontaneously, never heard before." So these three similes are about the wet and sappy piece of wood that was in the wet ground. And then the second, that means it was internally wet and externally wet. And the second piece of wood was inside wet, sappy, but on dry ground. And the third case was a dry piece of wood, inside dry, and on ground that was also dry. So the Buddha thought of this simile, that if a person has not, let me see, 3, 3, 5. If a person is not bodily and mentally withdrawn from sensual pleasures, then he can never attain the supreme enlightenment. Another one, he's mentally and bodily withdrawn from sensual pleasures, but the infatuation, thirst and fever for sensual pleasures has not been fully abandoned. Also, he cannot attain enlightenment. But the third case of the dry, sapless piece of wood on dry ground is a person who is bodily and mentally withdrawn from sensual pleasures, and also the fever and thirst for sensual pleasures has been fully abandoned and suppressed internally. Only this third type of person can attain enlightenment. I consider this Dhamma that I have attained is profound. So this, I guess there he talks about after he was enlightened, then he went to the five monk disciples of his and taught them the Dhamma. Then the monks of the group of five, not long after being thus taught and instructed by me, by realizing for themselves with direct knowledge, here now entered upon and abided in the supreme goal of the holy life, for the sake of which clansmen rightly go forth from the home life into homelessness. So here initially, the Buddha also taught that pleasure is not to be gained through pleasure. Pleasure is to be gained through pain. This is generally what ascetics in India taught, that the way to heaven is not by enjoying ourselves. They taught we have to suffer here, and then only we can be reborn in heaven or attain enlightenment. That's why most of them, the ascetics in India, they practice all kinds of austerities, torturing the body. So that's why also when the Buddha attained the Arupa Jhanas, he found it was so blissful, and he was not enlightened. Then he thought, this cannot be the way to enlightenment. It's so pleasurable, this meditation. So he gave up the meditation. So for many years, he did not use his meditation at all. Instead, he went to various ascetic practices, torturing himself until he nearly died. Then after that only, he considered again and realized all these ascetic practices is not the way. And then he reflected, and then he realized, must get back the jhana again. And then he ate one meal a day until his body was strong enough, and then he could enter the jhanas, and then he became enlightened. When this was said, Prince Bodhi said to the Blessed One, "Venerable Sir, when a monk finds a Tathagata to discipline him, how long is it until by realizing for himself with direct knowledge, he here and now enters upon and abides in the supreme goal of the holy life, for the sake of which clansmen rightly go forth from the home life into homelessness? As to that, Prince, I shall ask you a question in return. Answer it as you choose. What do you think, Prince? Are you skilled in the art of wielding a goat while riding an elephant?" "Yes, Venerable Sir, I am." "What do you think, Prince? Suppose a man came here thinking, 'Prince Bodhi knows the art of wielding a goat while riding an elephant. I shall train in that art under him.' If he had no faith, he could not achieve what can be achieved by one who has faith. If he had much illness, he could not achieve what can be achieved by one who is free from illness. If he was fraudulent and deceitful, he could not achieve what can be achieved by one who is honest and sincere. If he is lazy, he could not achieve what can be achieved by one who is energetic. If he was not wise, he could not achieve what can be achieved by one who is wise. What do you think, Prince? Could that man train under you in the art of wielding a goat while riding an elephant?" "Venerable Sir, even if he had one of those deficiencies, he could not train under me. So what of the five?" "What do you think, Prince? Suppose a man came here thinking, 'Prince Bodhi knows the art of wielding a goat while riding an elephant. I shall train in that art under him.' If he had faith, he could achieve what can be achieved by one who has faith. If he was free from illness, he could achieve what can be achieved by one who is free from illness. If he was honest and sincere, he could achieve what can be achieved by one who is honest and sincere. If he was energetic, he could achieve what can be achieved by one who is energetic. If he was wise, he could achieve what can be achieved by one who is wise. What do you think, Prince? Could that man train under you in the art of wielding a goat while riding an elephant?" "Venerable Sir, even if he had one of those qualities, he could train under me. So one of the five?" "So too, Prince, there are these five factors of striving." "What five?" "Here a monk has faith. He places his faith in the Tathagata's enlightenment. Thus, that Blessed One is Arhan Sammasambuddha, perfect in true knowledge and conduct, sublime, knower of worlds, incomparable leader of persons to be tamed, teacher of gods and humans, enlightened, blessed. Then he is free from illness and affliction, possessing a good digestion that is neither too cool nor too warm, but medium and able to bear the strain of striving. Then he is honest and sincere and shows himself as he actually is to the teacher and his companions in the holy life. Then he is energetic in abandoning unwholesome states and in undertaking wholesome states, steadfast, launching his effort with firmness and persevering in cultivating wholesome states. Then he is wise. He possesses wisdom regarding rise and disappearance that is noble and penetrative and leads to the complete destruction of suffering. These are the five factors of striving. Prince, when a monk who possesses these five factors of striving finds a Tathagata to discipline him, he might dwell 7 years. I'll stop here for a moment. So here the Buddha is saying, anybody who wants to learn, whether it is the art of riding an elephant and wielding a goat, or to strive in the holy path, there must be five qualities in him. First, he must have faith in the teacher. Without faith in the teacher, he cannot follow the teacher. He does not have enough faith. Secondly, he must be free from illness and affliction. Free from illness and affliction. He must be healthy. Because like in the spiritual path, we strive. We don't eat so much. And if you are not strong enough, it's not possible to strive. Especially like in the Buddha's days, they live outdoors, under the tree or in a cave and all that. Then number three, he must be honest and sincere. If a disciple is honest and sincere, he will tell his teacher his faults, his shortcomings. But if a person is not honest and sincere, he hides his faults, then the teacher cannot help him to progress. Then he must be energetic. Must be energetic. And then number five, he must be wise. Wise to see the Dhamma. Wise to conduct himself in the right way to progress. So all these five factors are important for a student. Prince, when a monk who possesses these five factors of striving finds a Tathagata to discipline him, he might dwell 7 years until by realizing for himself with direct knowledge, he here and now enters upon and abides in the supreme goal of the holy life, for the sake of which clansmen rightly go forth from the home life into homelessness. Let alone 7 years, Prince, when a monk who possesses these five factors of striving finds a Tathagata to discipline him, he might dwell 6 years, or 5 years, 4 years, 3 years, 2 years, 1 year. Let alone 1 year, Prince, he might dwell 7 months, 6 months, 5 months, 4 months, 3 months, 2 months, 1 month, half a month. Let alone half a month, Prince, he might dwell 7 days and nights, 6 days and nights, 5 days and nights, 4 days and nights, 3 days and nights, 2 days and nights, 1 day and night. Let alone 1 day and night, Prince, when the monk who possesses these five factors of striving finds a Tathagata to discipline him, then being instructed in the evening, he might arrive at distinction in the morning. Or being instructed in the morning, he might arrive at distinction in the evening. When this was said, Prince Bodhi said to the Blessed One, O the Buddha, O the Dhamma, oh, how well proclaimed is the Dhamma. For one instructed in the evening might arrive at distinction in the morning, and one instructed in the morning might arrive at distinction in the evening. Let's stop here for a moment. So here the Buddha says, if a person has these five factors of striving, if the Buddha were to teach him in the morning, he can even become enlightened in the evening. Or if he's taught in the evening, he can become enlightened in the morning. This does occur, but very rarely. We find the Theragata sometimes, certain young persons, about 7 years old, when they come to the Buddha or to the Arahants, the Buddha can see that this person was probably an ascetic in the previous life and already attained the four jhanas. That is a precondition, the four jhanas, for Anagamin, attaining the third fruit, or Arahanthood, the fourth fruit, must have four jhanas, either this life or the previous human life. So there were such cases where the Buddha allowed this young Samnera to go forth in the morning. By the evening, he became enlightened already, even sometimes with psychic powers. But that's very rare. And this was said, the Brahmin student Sanjika Putta said to Prince Bodhi, Master Bodhi says, oh the Buddha, oh the Dhamma, oh how well proclaimed is the Dhamma. But he does not say, I go to Master Gotama for refuge, and to the Dhamma, and to the Sangha of monks. Do not say that, my dear Sanjika Putta, do not say that. I have heard and learned this from my mother's lips. There was an occasion when the Blessed One was living at Kosambi in Gosita's park. Then my mother, who was pregnant, went to the Blessed One, and after paying homage to him, she sat down at one side and said to him, Venerable Sir, the prince or princess in my womb, whichever it may be, goes to the Blessed One for refuge, and to the Dhamma, and to the Sangha of monks. Let the Blessed One remember the child as a lay follower who has gone to him for refuge for life. There was also an occasion when the Blessed One was living here in the country of the Bhagas at Sungsu Maragira in the Besakala Grove, the deer park. Then my nurse, carrying me on her hip, went to the Blessed One, and after paying homage to him, she stood at one side and said to him, Venerable Sir, this Prince Bodhi goes to the Blessed One for refuge, and to the Dhamma, and to the Sangha of monks. Let the Blessed One remember him as a lay follower who has gone to him for refuge for life. Now, my dear Sanjika Putta, for the third time I go to the Blessed One for refuge, and to the Dhamma, and to the Sangha of monks. Let the Blessed One remember me as a lay follower who has gone to him for refuge for life. That's the end of the sutta. So this last part, the Buddha, this prince says, even when I was in my mother's womb, I already took refuge in the triple gem. And as a small boy, my nurse or maid also brought me to take refuge with the Buddha, Dhamma and Sangha. So now for the third time, I take refuge. So this sutta, the main thing here is these five factors of striving. If somebody wants to strive on the holy path, he should possess these five factors.